Morsenal Studio B in Chandler, Arizona, this is MayaCast.
Welcome to another edition of MayaCast. I'm your host, Tom Shadle.
I'm your host, Kip Barcel.
And this is episode 257 for Friday, January 3rd, 2020. The show of Force Awakens. Coming up on today's show, we are going to be talking about the mission Show of Force, which features a tag in the scoring options. And because there's a few factions that don't have access to one, it hasn't shown up on a lot of tournaments. But this year, it's already shown up on two of the big Dire States events in the Southwest, at least the Southwest, the Salt Lake Showdown and the Rumble on Roots. Well, Salt Lake, we imagine, is going to contain Show of Force because all of their advertising has included tag pictures, and they've been strongly hinting it's going to involve tags, so we can assume Show of Force there, but it's definitely going to be at the Rumble on Route 66, the largest Infinity tournament in the world. So,
interesting. Interessante.
So we're going to talk about Show of Force a little bit today, but we also have a whole lot of giveaways to give out for our Patreons from November and December. We barely had any shows in November at all, and then didn't get to it in the holidays, so we're going to get to it now and catch up. And we also have some listener emails to get to, just a couple of those, real quick ones. First, we're going to talk about MayaCast Masterclass Quarter 4. You may have noticed that the gallery has gone up on Facebook, and you may have panicked because you didn't finish yet, but don't worry about it. I put the gallery up because I had time. I've got stuff to paint for Warsenal, but the primer takes like 4 hours to cure. So I had a window where I could do all of it, because it took like 3 hours to do all the master glass stuff.
And I can imagine.
So I had to do it now because I had the time. And but you can still throw some entries in over the weekend, and as long as you get them in by Tuesday or so, because we'll record either Tuesday or Wednesday of next week, and by the time we record, then it's too late to keep adding. But you've got over the weekend, so that only applies if you are A, caught up on all your episodes, and B, listening right away on Friday. So then, but yeah, so even though the gallery is up, you can still get those last minute entries in. We already have 82.
Good night. That's amazing.
It looks like we have 83. Because Gavin Bateman, there are two different models, and if you're like, what's this guy doing breaking the rules? I thought it was one entry per person. Fret not. One is his entry, and the other one he just sent along. To show off, and they were both so cool that we didn't want to we wanted to keep it to ourselves. We wanted to share with everybody.
Especially, he's dealing with some huge fires right now. If you are friends with him on Facebook, which I am, but they're having lots of fires in Australia, so all of our Aussie listeners, I hope you guys are safe, and really hard to see that, because like the whole country is burning right now. Thoughts really, are with you.
Really, really sad state of affairs. I heard like 450 million dead animals.
Yeah, it's pretty sad.
Oz is on fire. Speaking of Oz and whatnot, we do have a couple of events to announce. Kip, what you got for us?
This one comes in and says, "Hi, Tom, here's one especially for Kip." And then I saw it and then laughed because it goes as is. Just as CanCon is the Gen Con of Australia. It's actually CanCon is the Gen Con of CanCon. CantCon is the CanCon of Western Australia. Being stuck 3,000 kilometers away from CanCon doesn't mean you can't play some games on the 25th of January in Perth, which is in Western Australia. They're having a small four-game ITS tournament on the 25th of January at the South Perth South Perth? that's really hard
easy
to say.
Easy for you to say. Yeah.
South Perth Community Hall, hosted by the Outpost 6030 Gaming Club. Looks like tickets are going to be $25 or Australian dollars to enter. It's going to be at the corner of South Terrace and Sandgate Street, South Perth. Missions are going to be, I just like to say South Perth. It's really hard to do. Missions are supplies, transmission matrix, power pack, and another great one, The Armory. It's going to be 2 hours and 20 minutes per round, two lists, 300-point ITS, no spec ops. It says there's going to be numerous prizes available, key ones being for first, second, and third, plus painting contest for best miniatures with the journalist skill. Huh. How interesting is that? And also for best sport. There's going to be a Facebook link, and there'll be an event tab, so we'll have that in the show notes. But that's kind of funny that they're having the CantCon during CanCon.
Can confirm.
Can confirm. Well played, sir.
Russ Bell Ruckus writes in and says, come to Cleveland.
Blech.
And battle in the Midwest second annual Rust Belt Ruckus against fantastic players from across the country. In addition to normal ITS prizes and trophies, there will be a Best in Faction award that takes into account your overall performance as well as your appearance. I assume they mean the appearance of the army and not your physical grooming and or sense of style. We'll be meeting for dinner the night before as well as after the event. Event registration opens on January 6, 2020. Through the Rust Belt Ruckus Facebook group. Entry is $40. This is a 300-point ITS event on June 20th, 2020, and is an interplanetario satellite event. One day, four rounds capped at 80 players. Missions are unmasking, safe area, power pack, and looting and sabotage. There is a location shift. While the Hilton Garden Inn Airport is the official hotel site, the event has been moved 1.5 miles down the road to Pro Kart Racing's event room due to a hotel remodel. The Hilton Garden Inn will be providing shuttles to and from the hotel. Or you could take 20 minutes and walk 1.5 miles.
Oh, it's only 1.5 miles?
1.5 miles, 1.5 miles. So Rust Belt Ruckus, CantCon, those are the events. And let's get into the, I think we got two or three or four really quick listener emails, and that gives us an excuse to play this bumper we haven't used in a long time.
Yeah.
Captain, incoming message.
This is Brian from College Station, Texas.
There's a letter in your mailbox.
This is Bonnie.
You've got mail.
This is Emmett from Las Vegas, Nevada.
I am an idiot.
This is Dan Cade.
Message for you,
son. Find me from Croatia.
Tom@MayaCast.com
or Kip@MayaCast.com.
So our first email comes from a Tomo. I hope I say that correctly. And he says, or she says, hello, Tom and Kip. I was listening to your show about Infinity Code 1 the other night, and you had some really great insights on the subject. One thing I saw Carlos talking about in some video, sorry, I don't remember which, was that one thing hobby shops are always asking CB is what products of theirs should they carry? And how difficult of a question it is for CB to actually answer. So from what I understand from the video is that one of the aims of Code 1 would be to have the SKU light version of the game, which would also make it easier for retailers to have in their selection. What do you think this kind of low SKU code one would look like? Keep up the great work, and special congrats to Kip on joining the club for those who have probably made love successfully twice. Have a good Christmas. Merry Christmas, Tomo. That is hilarious.
Is it T-O-M-O?
T-U-O-M-O.
Nah.
Like Tuomo.
So yeah, anything they can do to reduce SKUs and make their product less confusing and more accessible would be a good thing. Mm-hmm. You have to understand the fact that the distributors do not know the product. They do not care about the product. It is their job to be knowledgeable about all of the products, but mm-hmm. they are not, and they do not. So as the more you can streamline it and keep it simple is and easy is better. So what would a code one force one? What would a code one SKU list look like? Well, I imagine the core. If all the products stay similar to how they are now, if you listen to the Christmas show where we gave wish lists, mm-hmm. I talked about wanting them to like redo everything to make it to significantly cut down their SKUs by like 40%, repackage everything and mm-hmm. have things that make more sense. and but we'll just work with what we know, which is what we have now. I would say starter boxes, remote boxes, support packs, right? Would be like the three main core boxes for any faction, and then maybe one like fancy box. So like most factions have a tag, and those are like eye catching. You see that on the shelf, you know, it's a five. I'm going to buy it even though I don't play the game, type of thing. Or what, you know, so one, maybe something like that, or the secondary core troop that everybody like. So in Pano, you've got your Fusiliers in the starter box. Maybe you've got the Fusiliers SWC boxes at fourth box, right? But you need the remotes, you need the support pack, you need the starter box. And then as few blisters as possible.
Yeah, that's where people get kind of confused. And I just hope that they don't like do the whole, I'm going to downgrade code one, and then that's all people ever really see. And well, if they're not playing ITS now, it doesn't matter. Sounds like with us, we're very used to all of that stuff. And if you have stores that only carry like code one, it's like, how do you transition? How do you build that bridge?
Sure, it could be
to Terabithia.
It could be very dangerous. You've got a shopkeeper that only like, you know, he only likes 40K, but he carries the stuff because he's running a business, right? But he really only knows 40K, so he doesn't know all this Infinity stuff. And they give him a list of this is all you need to carry. Then they're going to get that list and stick to it.
Yeah. I mean, they could special order once people like learn, but like unless there's a war core there or somebody that champions it and like transitions out of code one into full fledged. I don't know.
There is no starter box because they repackage every, like, you know, the 300 point boxes.
Yeah, that's what I'm hoping to see.
So maybe every faction has a 300 point, and not every sectorial, but every main faction has a 300 point starter box. And then, because there may not even be sectorials in Code 1.
Probably not.
So every main faction has a 300 point starter box, and then maybe that already has your remotes and your support pack in it. And so who knows?
That would be the way to go. Especially if they are around like the $80 to $100 range.
There's upsides and downsides, right? Like some people don't want to spend $100 to get into a game. They're like, I'll buy this $45 box and play to see if I like it, but I'm not going to spend twice that. That's crazy, you know?
That's true.
So it may price some people out if that's the starting point is a $100 box. But in this hobby, it really shouldn't be in this day and age.
I know, right?
Where a single plastic GW Hero is $35.
Or some of the big things are like $60. What do you want your $70 tank?
$150, yeah.
Yeah, it's like, come on.
But yeah, so, cool. So I have an email from Santa Thematic.
Yeah.
And Mike Bohr, we said, you know, if you have naughty and nice lists or wish lists from the Christmas episode, send us what you'd like. And so he has one wish for 2020, and he said he'd like to see more cool terrain sets like what came with Wildfire. And then it says, Merry Christmas to you both, Santa Thematic.
Hey, I agree with that. Terrain is Infinity. Like, you can't have Infinity without cool terrain. So stuff that's that easy.
And it's pre-printed, and you just stick it together, and it stacks up and stores really well. No, it's excellent. I would like more of the buildings or building-like things over the little barricades and things. The way those feet stick out make movement around them somewhat annoying if you're trying to maintain cover at a corner and the little tabs push you out too far, right?
And so, walkways.
As far as gameplay goes, those tabs on the scatter train are a little bit of an issue for smooth and clean play. I understand you know, they've got to go together, you know, so you need slots and tabs. But yeah, I know the super thick cardboard, all pre-colored, double-sided was fantastic. And yeah, so yeah, walkways, more buildings of varied types. Yeah, I hope that's the direction they keep going and don't go back to the flimsy cardboard.
Yeah, I always like the multi-level aspect of Infinity. It gives way more character. Super fun. So here's one from Stop Hobby Time from Kevin. It says, hey guys, catching up with some episodes, and I really enjoy the content of this one. It's someone who travels for work. It's a blessing sometimes being alone in a hotel room with nothing to do but paint. So it's great to hear I'm not the only one. I'm with you, Kevin. It was a great little insight into your hobby world and a realization that we all have various struggles in our lives. And on a personal note, it was really helpful to hear you both speak candidly about it. So he says, thank you again. I look forward to hearing more in the future. Thank you for that, Kevin. Yeah, man, some of the sacrifices. I got like the new, my little sister-in-law, who she's like 20, got me that new Jedi game. What is it? The
Fallen Order?
The Fallen Order. And I'm looking at it, and I was like, Charlie, why would you do this? Now I actually have to start making decisions again. I was like, you realize every minute I play this game, I'm not painting. I was like, I haven't touched my PS4 in about 8 months since I started the Mando project, like in May.
That's a super thoughtful gift,
so
though.
She
knows your wheelhouse.
Oh, man. So it's like now it's one of those things. It's like you just, you know, using that free time.
And this is the one that keeps hitting cars with other people's cars?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Love you, Charmander. She doesn't listen to the show, but anyways.
Why would she? So the last email is a simple shout out. And Michael Say wrote in to say, I was hoping you could give a shout out to Joel Vaughn of maybe still existing podcast fame, ? He recently ran, and that would be the Remote Presence podcast. Mm-hmm. Check that out. He recently ran a narrative event here in the Twin Cities, and it was a riot. His thoughtful planning and tweaks to the game made for probably the most fun I've had in this game so far, since Red Veil on and off, mostly off. He really made me feel welcome as someone new to the area and just really knocked it out of the park. Thanks. So there's a shout out to Joel Vaughn in the Twin Cities area, running an awesome narrative event. Hopefully someone will pick up the torch of the Twinfinity Open and get that going again. So that's it for emails. Now let us get into the mission Show of Force. Mission debrief. So we got Show of Force, and let's talk about the scoring real quick, because you know, you say this is a mission you need a tag for. Well, why do you say that? And it all comes down to the scoring, which is really interesting. There is a central antenna on the field, and you get 3 objective points if you control that at the end of the game, meaning you are the only one with a model in base contact with it. If one of your controlling models is a tag, you get an additional 3 points. That's why we say it's the tag mission, the lone remaining mission where tag is a requirement. If your data tracker is one of your controlling models on the antenna, it's worth plus 1 point. And then if you kill more army points than your opponent does, that's worth 3 points as well. So there are no classified points. It's just, and these are all zero-sum scoring parameters. Like, if you get it, the other person does not get it, right? And so there's a very limited outcomes of different scores that you can get. Like 8, 5, 2, and 1, you can't reach those numbers on either side. So those are just right out, right? You can go 10-0, 9-0, 7-0, 6-0, 4-0, 3-0. You can also go 7-3, 6-3, 4-3, 3-3. That's it. Those are the only combinations, which is 4 ways to get a major, 5 minors, 1 tie. Well, it's not true, because you can go 0-0 if no one controls the thing with anything.
Yeah.
And you kill exactly the same number of army points.
Which happens.
Well, in 10 years of Infinity, it's happened to me twice. That's it.
Not very likely, but it can.
Always crazy. So there's technically 2 ways to tie. 3-3 or 0-0. 0-0 is not very likely. So if you don't take a tag, you are limiting yourself to a maximum of 7 objective points possible, right? Instead of having all 10 available to you. And if you get those seven, that's great. You will get a major because your opponent will have zero.
Or six, if you don't have your data tracker left.
Yeah, if you get six, you will get a major. And if you don't have a tag, your opponent will have zero at that point because you will have the kill more army points and control the antenna. So with or without data tracker, seven or six. Anyway, so you're limiting yourself to seven. That is kind of a big deal, though. Now, we should say that Interplanetario, 2 or 3 years ago now, whatever it was, they had the tag missions in there, and a guy who didn't bring tags won the whole thing, right? But you go to these larger tournaments with 40, 50, 120 people, and you look at those scores, especially like the more people there are, the more likely it is, where you are going to have the same number of tournament points as 20 other people. And what's the first tiebreaker is objective points. Those objective points matter. You want to get as many as you can. So, you know, you end up with, you know, your 9 tournament points, but so does some other guy, but he brought a tag and you lose first place by 3 OP that you never had a chance of getting going in. That sucks.
Yeah, it does.
Armored Vanguard, if you do bring a tag, it will get forward deployment level 1, which is kind of cool. An extra 4 inches, although they tend to have long-range weapons, and getting closer is not always better until the very end when you need to run up to the middle. But yeah, so we know Rumble's going to have it. It's likely that Showdown is going to have it because of all their teasing with the tag pictures and saying tag and tag, tag, tag. So we're playing it this year. You just breathed in like you were going to say something, so
yeah,
I stopped. I stopped talking because I was like, oh, Kip's going
to
say something.
No, I was. Then I had one of those Kip moments where I went to say something, and then I was like, squirrel. No, it's interesting to me because I actually like it. That's what I was going to say. I think it's interesting to throw something like this out there because I find, like, across a lot of different tournament scenes, you see kind of the similar missions that keeps everything equal, and as much as we like to make everybody happy, you can't always make everybody happy, so why not throw some stuff in the, you know, like throw some wrenches in the cogs, because the missions are there. It's like they're there to play, and we can't just boycott them because we're like, well, we don't like that because we don't want to force people to play tags. Well, you can throw it in there, and if you don't want to take a tag, don't take a tag. Just figure out how you can engineer that mission to your army, like the gentleman who won Interplanetario by not taking them. And I like that. I like stuff that makes you kind of think in a different way. That's why I was really happy with Tactical Window, and I was hoping that more of these would be Tactical Window so that you're not going to see the same 18-order list that you played the same guy 2 tournaments in a row. You know, it's like, well, I went to 2 big events, and I randomly got paired with the same guy, and it's the same list in both times. You know, there's no variety. There's no, you know, trying something new. There's no, like, learning the entire army. So I like when stuff like this is thrown in there.
There are 37 factions in Infinity. There are 9 main factions and 28 sectorials. And let's talk about who's screwed. There are 4... There are 4 sectorials that do not have a tag, and they are all sectorials. All of the main factions have access to a tag. The 4 that get screwed are ISS, and how they do not have a Guijia is beyond me, especially when you read, like, the Outrage comic, and they dropship, like, 6 Guijias onto the AOE. AOE? Area of?
Effect?
A-O-O. Area of operations.
There you go.
I was not in the military.
Neither was I.
So, yeah. So, ISS, Caledonia. They have lots of freedom. Lots of blue face paint. No tags.
No tags. No heavyweights.
No heavyweights either. Yeah. Oh, that's worth pointing. Well, let's finish the list. Hassassin Baram, no tags. And Steel Phalanx. So, those are the 4 sectorials out of the 37 options you have to play. Those 4 do not have access to a tag or a heavyweight. What is this heavyweight you speak of? Heavyweights that rule that, like, blackjacks have and the Magariba Guard has, where they can't fit through doors, right?
The Ratnik.
The Ratnik has it. Mm-hmm. And in this season of ITS, things with heavyweight count as tags for scoring purposes, which is specifically for this mission.
Mm-hmm.
So you can use a Blackjack or a Ratnik to go and take that central console. Or a Daiyokai.
Yeah, Daiyokais are heavyweight.
For your
too.
JSA, you don't need to take the Oyoroi.
Mm-hmm.
You can use your Daiyokai Dengeketai to go take it instead. So heavyweights and tags are what you need to take that central console. And those four sectorials don't have one. Well, if you're not bringing a tag, bring stuff to take out tags.
Yeah.
In fact, even if you are, tags. Still do that.
Yeah, I know, right? That's kind of what I was thinking, too, because like when I was looking at this, there's two factions in here that I like. Well, Caledonia, first love, want to play it again. Steel Phalanx, played last Rumble. So I was looking, I'm like, what do you do if you really love this army and you're like, well, this one mission... I can't take a tag. Well, let's see how you counter them. Three things came to mind that all of these have at least some access to. And my thing was Assault Hackers. And then people at Caledonia are like, come on, how can it be that person? They have other stuff. Adhesive ammunition or weaponry. And then explosive / AP / mono / dual wield T2 AP. Close combat weapons, you can get a lot of people in. So that's kind of what you're going to want to focus on, because everybody's going to go to the center spot. And a lot of times, it's not really good to do that turn one and then try to hold it the whole time. It's going to be like a turn two, turn three thing. So it's like, how can you make it really hard for that extra 3 points or those models to get on there? And Assault Hackers would be the one. So like in ISS, I think that my favorite units to cover that would be Can Ren. So if I'm playing ISS, I really like playing ISS. You have a lot of other things that can go and take out more army points, because that's the other three. You have a lot of options to do that. But then your Can Ren is going to be, they have Holo Projector level 2. You can take the Combi Rifle Mad Trap to maybe go up and go prone and have those Mad Traps out there. Put them on standby so they can do their adhesive thing. And then you have the Canron Assault Hacker, both of which have monofilament close combat weapons. So if you either glue a tag or immobilize it or isolate it, even if they do get to the console, you can make a Mad Dash close combat on them and kill them outright with your monofilament close combat weapon. So that's not a bad thing to take. They also have access to, and I'm on ISS right now, the Ninja Assault Hackers. They're 40 points.
See, this is the money in the bag play, is having a TO, no matter what faction, right? Having a TO infiltrating Assault Hacker somewhere within, you know, a good 6 inches of that console, so you can reach all points in contact with it. Just hiding out until turn three, not even using it. Just leaving it, no marker, right? You're down that just order the whole game.
Yeah.
But leaving it there, and when that tag tries to get there, you try to immobilize it so it can't get there.
Or take it over. That's why I like Assault Hackers. They're really, really good at taking out heavy infantry and tags. We have a number of different programs that you can use to either possess, isolate, immobilize, pretty much take him out. And that's why it was my number two. Like, I like the Canron.
And so there's a lot of confusion around possession in this mission specifically, because people say, so I possessed your tag, it's now my tag, so now am I controlling that console with a tag? The answer is no, because possessed is a null state. Go check the label. And you can't control anything if you're in a null state.
Yeah, that's why I like the possession too, is if it's on turn three, it counts as a null, so they're not controlling it anymore. If it happens on turn two, then you can run away with it, and then they shoot their own people with it and force them to be like, do I kill my own thing?
On Monday night, viciously effective Zach possessed one of either Dylan or Matthew's tags. I don't know which one he was playing. They're twins. And but yeah, so took control of his tag and was going to run around and kill his whole army with his own tag. Except he got flash pulsed like after the second order or whatever. And so the tag was now blind.
Oh, right? That's funny.
And so instead of running around killing everybody, he climbed the tag to the top of a 3-story building and then jumped up and off.
Oh, that's hilarious.
So that it took a damage 30 hit when it hit the ground.
Oh, that's funny.
And he couldn't save, and you just keep making it so it just disintegrates.
Yeah, that's funny.
So
hey, that is.
Let's say it was Dylan. I'm going to say it was Dylan.
All right.
And so, you know, Dylan is like, oh no, he's got my tag. What am I going to do? I can flash pulse it. That won't hurt it. And then he stops killing me. Mm-hmm. And then it works. And so he's like, yes. And then he starts climbing up the building. He's like, uh-oh. Then he jumps it off the building. He's like, no. Oh.
And that makes sense too, because if you possessed your opponent's weapon, you would want to do that. It's like suicide jump. Oh, that's funny.
Anyway, so yes, possession is an option because it's a null state. So, like you do it on turn 3.
Yeah.
Right? And they don't get another turn to get it back.
Yes.
Then it's a null state. Doesn't count as scoring.
Mm-hmm. And it's also an extra benefit is if it's turn 2, they're like, well, I'm going to run up turn 2 and then go into suppression, right, with a couple other people. It gives you that. It's insurance. That you could actually take it over, and now they're like, oh crap, and then like I said, run that thing away to sync their orders while you have a couple people up there ready to go to take it over on your turn 3.
So yeah, pocket TO assault hacker is very valuable.
Really like it.
On the flip side of that, what is also very valuable is sensor bots, or someone in the army with sensor, and then flash pulse bots that have sniffers. And you can run up there and drop a sniffer near the central console, and then it gets blasted, whatever. The remote gets blasted, it was 8 points, big deal. But now your sensor, who is safe somewhere, does the sensor thing to reveal those sneaky TO people that might be hiding near the console to make a last grab at it, or to shut down your tag.
That's why the Canren is my favorite, because they're just hollow projectors, so you can kind of hide them. And so they do have Imperial agents. They have assault hacker. They also, that's 53 points, but I kind of like the fact of taking like 2 Canren, because it's only 7 points more. It's 2 orders, and now you have 6 potential models up there that could be your target with mad traps, and one's a hacker. Imperial agents usually are going to be in a fire team anyway, so that could be like a last turn effort.
Don't know.
Dang, why do I always forget words, Tom? Honorable mention. Honorable mentions. See, I should write this down when I'm thinking about it. Are the 12-point authorized bounty hunters. In a lot of the factions, I'm like, man, I really don't want to spend 12 points on that because you can make it useful other places. But in this and Show of Force, hey, they're 12 points. They're a regular order. You have acrylite cannons. There's panoplies that you can reload them in. And they have booties, so you can get really cool weapons, like adhesive launchers.
Speaking of booty, in addition to that central antenna we've talked about, there are also 2 panoplies along the center line of the table, which you can absolutely ignore because they are not relevant to scoring whatsoever. But how they are relevant is, like you said, you can get adhesive out of them. Although... Mm-hmm. Tags have super high physique. It's not always a money shot. glue gun. but more importantly, you can reload your Liberto's DEP.
Yeah, that's the thing, is reload them things, man. So I don't. I think that's really, they're good for that last. You put them up. If you have 2 of them, put them up the last ditch effort and pop a couple acrylite cannons. Sforza is also available in ISS. He has that non-dogged 25-point version. With viral, but tags usually have high, but in ADHL, he is the least on my list, because I've played against ISS a lot, and I don't see a lot of people taking him, because that 25 points can be spent much better elsewhere to take people out, like 5 Quangxi.
Well, and I mean,
oh my goodness,
you're also probably taking a Xian. Yeah. Anyway, because he's got the MSV2, you've got a preponderance of cheap smoke, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so he's doing the shoot through smoke trick, and tags, Most of them don't have visors. And
that's a Marut.
Right. So you can do the shoot through smoke trick with an HMG damage 15, or you have a damage 15 AP close combat weapon. It's damage 14 because he's physique 14, but he's got martial arts level 1.
Mm-hmm.
So the Shien not only can shoot them from afar, but can also go up. And that was my Google home device chiming in, as it were. He can also go up and smack him with his stick with his close combat of 19 and martial arts level 1 to whack him with an AP close combat weapon at damage 15 if things get really grim. Or if the Shien's your data tracker and you're getting him up to the console anyway.
Yeah, see, and that's the other thing is the data tracker. I know it's only worth 1 point, but it is 1 point. And in this mission, I kind of want somebody that's going to be like chilling that can make a mad dash turn 3. Like, right. Hopefully you can already clear that out, and then you get
somebody
that
that's not
point.
Your tag.
Yeah, I would not make it the tag.
So all your eggs are not in the one basket?
Yeah, exactly. But a Shien, that might be, because he's hanging out, attacking, getting out of the way.
Yeah, you're taking him anyway.
Yeah, could be.
Although maybe not, because you already have to take the Guijia.
Yeah.
And now there's
well, not
half,
an ISS. There's
half, oh, sorry,
yeah.
ISS.
Yeah, we're talking ISS. Yeah.
And all the ISS players are like, yeah, if we had it, jerk, salt in the wound.
Oh, man. But yeah, that's, so there's, they have a lot of options though. And in ISS, there's, I'd be kind of afraid to go like take a tag in there. Although they could, you know, with the counter to that Canren is like, oh, you brought the Canren with mad traps. I'm just going to run units I don't care to go take them out before my tag meets up. So that could be kind of like a waste of points there, because then once it's out, it's like, well, you have a combi rifle there. So the Assault Hacker is my number one choice, followed by like the TO Ninja, because then you're not expecting it. And then all of your other guns, because you have to kill points. So you are taking the Quangxi, you are taking your Shiens.
The Assault Hackers are almost mandatory if you're expecting the other guy to have tags. Like,
yeah.
Even if it's turn 3 and they get up there with their tag, it's in cover, controlling the console, and it goes into suppression fire, right? You've got to get it out of suppression fire to try and deal with it. So assault hacker from out of line of fire, forcing, you know, makes it reset, drops it out of suppression so that you can, you know, if the hacking attack fails, you can apply bullets or whatever else you want to do. But yeah, it's so good for taking things out of suppression.
Yeah.
Hackable things. Because that's your greatest defense once you get up there. So it's interesting whether you want to go first or second.
I think it depends on the army you're playing, honestly. Because there's armies that have smoke. There's Eclipse smoke, which we'll get into when we talk about Steel Phalanx. And if you go first, why not pop Eclipse smoke and put every mod, like put 4 or 5 models surrounding the whole thing?
Because missile launchers and heavy rocket launchers exist?
And then, well, yeah. Well, hopefully you've killed them first.
They're going to get a turn.
Yeah, well, hopefully you kill them first before turn 3. And on your turn 3, if you go first, you surround it and there's no more template weapons. You have people prone, like all your silhouettes, so they can shoot over and everybody's in suppression fire. Because even if they take them down, and you go unconscious, now that's an extra order to coup de grace, and hopefully you can get through, you know, the gaps. So there's some really fun ways that you can surround that center console with multiple models if you have smoke, which I would do if I needed to.
But if you go first, you get to be aggressive and remove the enemy tag before it gets to do anything.
Remove the missile launchers.
Or remove the threats to your own tags, like missile launchers, like assault hackers. You get to throw your sensor out there and reveal him before he's ready. On the other hand, if you're going second, you do get to make that last mad dash at the console. So let's say you have no hope of taking out the tag that is entrenched, right? You can still run up to the console and just touch it with something, right? You may not be getting those 3 points for controlling, but now neither is he.
Yep.
And you can take 7 points away from the dude who went first by just getting one model into base contact with it. and he goes from winning 7-0 to you tying, you know, or not, somebody's probably going to win 3-0 because of the kill points, right? But yeah, you can steal 7 points from him just by touching a guy to that console, which is another argument for surrounding it because now they can't get in.
Yeah, that's kind of one of my... And you could stagger people too, because like you.
Please surround it. I've got heavy flamethrowers.
Yeah, true. Again, depending on the army, but it could be a last ditch effort. And that kind of comes from like the next one, Caledonia, because they don't have hackers. They have a war driver, which is regular hacker. There's no assaults.
No, you said it right the first time. They don't have hackers.
Yeah, true, right? So, and your only adhesive option is the dozer. With the Acrolyte Cannon, which it's 14 points, could be a filler. But in Caledonia, you're like, man, that's 14 points. I could take two more orders in volunteers for that.
I mean, they only have 20 total troop options to begin with.
Yeah. So, I mean, and I love Caledonia. So, my way that I would do it, Wallace is a given because you need everybody to be regular. For the points, and I kind of have like a number one and number two combined. So we're gonna start with McMurrow. They bring a tag, you bring McMurrow. He brings his own smoke. He's now regular with regular impetuous. So he's only gonna go impetuous if you want him to. You can hide him. He has his own smoke. He has a double action plus AP close combat weapon, which is really scary for tags. And he's also martial arts level 3, which you downgrade to level 2, which makes it damage 19, which is fun. And then he hits on like a 24 at that point, because I think it's plus 1 as well. But yeah, you throw him at a tag, and then they can't move, because once he's engaged, people can just shoot in there if they want. But a couple of orders of damage 19 on that is pretty scary. But I would actually also, because you can do this, back him up with Kaden and Wolvers. Because now that Kaden's a thing.
T2 close combat.
But he's dual wield, so it's AP T2 on a 25mm base that can either be a Haris or a core team with Wolvers. He has Natural Born Warrior, which gives him plus 3, because your most tags don't have martial arts. And he is a 23 base, so that's a 26. For the Natural Born Warrior. Plus, you could do the plus 6 and be a 32.
Right, because he has 2 wounds.
So yeah.
If you still have your 2, you don't worry about the 1 that the tag can do to you. You know, double check, make sure you have them tell you what close combat weapons the tag has before you charge it.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, explosive, you're like, uh-oh.
Yeah, I know, right?
Don't do this to a Sphinx.
I know, right? But yeah, you could do that. But the thing with them being 25 millimeters, you can be running a Haris team, and there's plenty of smoke that can actually clear your way to make this first strike. Way-oh. Because if you get all 3 in there, that's a burst 3 berserk. Even if they have explosive, I'll take that. I'll take three berserk shots at plus 12. So you're critting on 8s. And it's T2. I'll take 3 bursts on that. But they auto-hit anyway, and that's damage 15 because of Natural Born Warrior as well. Like, that's a missile. And and you can do him and McMurrow, a bunch of cheap units. Like, that's one thing with Caledonia is with his Killmore Army points, it's really easy to trade points with Caledonia.
He's a little expensive. He's a little obvious. You know what's not obvious is the SAS. They're camo markers that infiltrate, so they can be right up nearby. And then close combat 19, martial arts level 2 with an AP close combat weapon. So they're cutting the armor in half and then hitting on physique 16.
16s. That's not a bad thing. I've done this to Marut before. When I dropped an SAS, they're like, oh, what is that? Blah, blah. And then I started rolling. They're like, oh, you're close combat 19. Wait, it's damage 16 AP. Wait, what? And I killed a Marut. In close combat, fully like no wounds. It was against Bill, and he's like, that makes no sense. I'm like, dude, you can't hit me. I'm small. I'm like a little fly with a knife, and I'm just chopping all of your gears. So, like, you know, I'm just cutting tendons over here.
Stabbing in your eye crystals.
Yeah. So yeah, that SAS is the other option. I'm really into this Caden First Strike, though. Like, it makes me want to take Wolvers. Like, once they added him in, I'm like, I want to take Wolvers now. Because it's just disgusting against larger silhouettes. But like I said, yeah, lots of smoke. Easy to maneuver. And even if, like, especially you can hold them to the end of the game and then smoke out the center and just go crush whatever's holding that if you have second turn. And this is the one instance where I'm like, man, I want to motorize 112.
Yeah?
Yeah, that is my absolute favorite data tracker for this. Because if you're rocking a defensive fire team because you've spent your offense points doing a Harry's team, a McMurrow, mm-hmm. you're going to be rocking some volunteers. So having the 112 there, they can heal them. Because you can dismount and get up.
Yeah, and then get on his bike and move 8 inches.
8-4
towards the objective.
They have smoke grenade launchers. They're not impetuous. So that's my last turn rush. If you don't have somebody who's already smoking out, they're holding their own smoke for insurance, and it's an 8-4 move.
As long as it's
two orders, you're in the middle if you're close enough.
Yeah, as long as there's room to get in.
Yeah.
And if there's not, you can leap off the bike on the last order.
Jump in combat roll. You're like, safe.
Into the antenna.
I'm touching base.
And you're like, yeah, I may not have tags, but now neither do you. Ha ha ha. Not because you're dead, but because you're not controlling it.
How many times back in the day, especially against like a cutter, like I would just throw Cameronians at tags. And just basically, I was like, they're tackling you. Like they used to play in the dog bowl. They're like Buda Baker out there. They just run and hit you in the legs and hold you down.
But if you're going without a tag, no matter what faction you are, you need to remove theirs.
Yes.
Put yourself on equal footing. You need to remove theirs, and you need to make sure you're killing more army points.
Yes.
To secure yourself those three, but be careful. Because this mission ends in retreat. If somebody starts their turn in retreat, the game will end at the end of that turn. So you want to kill a lot. But you don't want to kill him too hard, so always keep that total in the back of your head.
See, that actually is scary, too, because if you do get first turn, and you do have your tag, and you run him up the middle, and you have some jump-out options, and you just smoke him on turn one, and it ends, you're like, oh, well, I'm on the middle, and I killed my army points because you're running away. Like, this is one of those missions that could literally end on the first turn.
You could literally, yeah.
If you have a good enough first turn, mm-hmm. and you could still get 10 points.
You could certainly play it that aggressive.
That's scary.
Yeah, it's definitely a roll of the dice when you push that hard.
Mm-hmm. But Phalanx. So Phalanx is kind of unique. Because the way I like to play Phalanx is at limited insertion. I think that, and I went through this on the show when we went to Rumble, you can get 15 to 16 wounds worth of models and still have 11 orders with doctors that move with you, and and nobody can strip your orders, so you can get to do exactly what you want to do with your teams. So I kind of went that route with this because your only 80 HLs are on Dactyls, which is probably the one mission I would actually run Dactyls because Thrakatai can do more for less points. and your assault hackers are Myrmidons, Cilia, or Ectromoy. And if you're trying to prevent them, like, you're waiting till turn three to drop an Ectromoy. I'm not really a fan of the Ectromoy assault hackers unless you're like, oh, they're hiding back there, I'm gonna go drop, take over, kill them with their own tag. So that's more of a first, second turn strategy, which you could do. I really like Myrmidon assault hackers because I have taken over tags that have come through, and you position your Myrmidon hacker first. So if they want to get to you, they have to go through that eight-inch zone. So I like the Myrmidon hacker the most because it's going to be in your Enematarkos. And for something like this, it's like 179 points, but I would rock it because you can still get a sufficient 10-order list. And that would be Hector, Ajax, Makeon and Myrmidon Assault Hacker. Because that's kind of what I played at Rumble in one of my lists. Because you have a Assault Hacker that can immobilize, isolate, or take over the tag. You have smoke in there in case they do get to the middle. You can smoke your way through and then surround the tag and get a burst 3 Ajax explosive hammer to the face at damage like 19 because he has martial arts too, which is what I would do if I wanted to kill it. And then now you're surrounding it. So even if it was the start of turn 3 and you run up and do that and then you surround it and you put everybody in suppression fire and all but all of them have weapons that can do suppression fire because you're rocking the Myrmidon with combi rifle, because that's what an Assault Hacker has, and three of which, or two of which have ODD. You have Hector in there that, with his plasma, Ajax, a lot of wounds. That's what I would do, honestly, and then I would back him up with some Thoracotai, but with Steel Phalanx, like, they don't really have, like, camo, they don't have, like, these surprise units that you see a lot.
Infiltrators.
Except, yeah, it's like you gotta, but what they have is really, it's, as Zach would say, viciously effective. So I would either rock some Dactyls with ADHLs to cover the middle, but you're killing, right? So you're like, that all that's doing is kind of making it safe for you to run through and shoot stuff without losing points. So I would probably run a more aggressive fire team like that with Thoracotai to back them up in ARO, because their Feuerbox are disgusting in ARO when you're part of a four-member fire team. and so are light rocket launchers, and you can take them very cheap with Thoracotai, and you have your badass Enematarkos of Doom with a Whip 15 Doctor that's rolling around with them with Eclipse Grenades.
Yep.
So, that's kind of what I got for Phalanx. Like, I think you just go straight for... That's what they do. You go straight aggressive, in my opinion.
Hassas and Baram has... They don't have infiltrating Assault Hackers. Their Assault Hackers start in the deployment zone or have to air combat drop in. You can take a Rajik Assault Hacker, like you said, with the Ektromoy, to jump in and pop the tag. But I think it's straight up kill the tag with your Fides. Fides have the AP close combat weapon. Now, I would take the double action guy a lot, right? Because double action, I want you to make two saves. But here, and it depends on the armor of the tag, right? I'd rather have double action against armor 6, but against armor 10 Jotun, I'd rather have the AP. But anyway, either case, it's a martial arts level 3, physique 12, so you can get up to 15 if you use level 2, right? And at close combat, 21. And with the impersonation 2 levels, right, you can probably get there on turn 1 and get rid of their tag, get yourself on even footing from the get-go. All your other assault hackers start in your deployment, Breeds, right? Breed starts in the deployment zone. That's a long, long trek to get into threat range, and he's not. There's no camo state, so what are you gonna do? But I mean, a Fide core team, Fide core team, not Fide. The other guys, the now I can't think of it. All I can think of is Fide, the core team in Assassins.
You have Muyibs.
Muyibs. That's it. The Muyib core team, they usually pack enough firepower to get any job done. But regardless of specific factions, right, it's like the themes are the same. You have to remove that tag or 4 tags, you know, gecko spam.
Yeah. I'll say, yeah, when you run into the geckos, really cheap guys.
You want to remove the tag or immobilize it. But on the positive note, though, right, like you've got all of the other factions, like that are not these 4 sad factions, you have, like, what did I say, 39 different factions? So you've got 35 or 37 factions. So you have 33 factions that can bring tags or heavyweights. So it gives you an opportunity to run something you may not normally run because they're thought of as not optimal for competition or whatever, right? And so maybe if you don't normally run tags, now you have an opportunity to play something with that's new and fun. But if you're going to do that, you're going to want to support that appropriately. So all of the things we were just talking about of what you can do to the enemy's tags, if you're one of these four factions that doesn't have them, well, how do you counteract that? So I think you need an engineer.
Yeah, definitely.
Because if you get immobilized with glue, he can go chip off the super glue, get you back in working order, right? Mm-hmm. If you get isolated, he can fix you. You know, so an engineer is probably, and probably a bot to keep the engineer safe and run the bots out there one at a time. Engineer is good support for a tag. Bringing your own hackers, killer hackers to fend off assault hackers. Save some SWC because the killer hackers are typically zero, whereas all the assaults are 0.5, right?
Mm-hmm.
So bring some killer hackers, get them out there where if they get in range of that tag, they also have to deal with the killer hacker. And bringing other guns to watch its rear. Like you got the Magariba Gar that you can take a 360 visor on, but you're going to have to choose a positioning, a line of fire. And how do you avoid the tag that's in suppression fire? Well, go behind it. Right? Out of its line of fire. Well, have buddies, have battle buddies covering its backside so that they can't do that easily. But yeah, so tags can be effective, but not as a like Rambo piece that you run out on its own with no friends and no support. You do need to support it properly. And, you know, another way to support tags, like, you know, you've got the all your eggs in one basket will bring multiple tags. There are several factions that have cheap tag options like Geckos or Zeodrons, right? Overdrawn? Zeodrons are the little ones.
Yeah, Zeos. Zeos are really good, especially up close because they're K1s, Red Furies. Or
well, that's the thing, right? These. This is such a funny mission because it wants you to bring your heavy weapon platform tag and then get it to the middle of the board where it's super close to everybody where its guns are useless.
Yeah, that's... That's the thing, and I was gonna say because like I don't really like to take blackjacks, but it's like man, this is if I play US because I really love US even though I haven't played it in a while. It's the one time I'd want to take blackjacks, but it's like man, in US there's so much SWC because your APHMG is two freaking points, but at that range when you're close, that gun's kind of useless. Like you're in the poor range and now you're like oh I'll use my heavy pistol or chess mines. It's like at that point I kind of do want to take the T2 sniper because he has a submachine gun and it's only one SWC.
Yeah.
So it's like it kind of makes you not only take
well, and like we said ideally you're not getting into that range until late in the game.
Yeah,
so you're still using man. Yeah,
it's just so freaking weird.
Those secondary weapon systems are super important when you're looking at your tags, though.
And I think a lot of people overlook that. Oh, my tag, I need to go here. It's like, well, what option do you take? Because, yeah, of course I want, oh, I get my burst 4 APHMG. Well, if you don't even get to use them until you're up close, now you're shooting everything at like a 10 or a 7. That's not optimal, especially if they have a shotgun and they're coming back at you at an 18.
No, your best offense there is defense, getting suppression fire. At least you're at a zero range ban.
Yeah, and I like that about the T2 sniper. It's like you have a long range weapon, and then when you get close, you can go into suppression with your submachine gun, which is AP or shock. So I don't know, man. It's really cool. But I do like focusing on the factions that don't have these tags. Because when you do that, it kind of gives you an idea of what you need to take out to save your own, like you said. So take out their assault hackers. You have to think, what would I do to get rid of their extra 3 points and kind of look for that to happen to you and try to counter that. So you're going to have mines. You're going to have ADHLs. If you're playing O12, you're probably going to have a lot of serious bots that are up in the middle, you know, ready to glue you so they can go and smoke you at. Because the thing about gluing them, especially in these missions where you have to kill more points, like I love gluing things down because you stop them and now you can shoot them without any retaliation, which is really nice. So it's not just the fact of, oh, I stopped them because it's still the order there.
You got to win the face-to-face roll with a single die, right? And then they have to fail. It's probably a 50-50 shot for them to fail the physique roll because tags are going to be 15, 16, 17.
Yeah.
So 16, you need a 10 or less, right?
So I prefer the hackers. But glue's nice with templates.
Yeah, so I don't know about, yeah, relying on that one face-to-face. Now, if you can get it unopposed from behind, sure. But,
or like, so I said, O12 with serious bots, because then they can shoot and you're like, well, I can dodge or hopefully just take the bullets and shoot back and pass that auto hit.
You're a tag. You're probably not afraid of the bullets so much.
True.
But crits are a thing.
Yeah.
Crits are definitely a thing. You know, over in TAC, you can take two ratniks instead of your three blackjacks in U.S. And there you're a little better off because you get two molotovs on the one guy.
Yeah.
So 0 to 8 is zero. Before you get to your plus three, but you know, it's a much better range than toting a sniper rifle to the center of the table
or an APHMG.
Heavy pistol for that 0 to 8 range. Yeah, so you can do it.
Yeah, I kind of like those little tags like geckos and zeos
because
you can take multiple and they're scary.
Yeah, I've seen, you know, take the overdrawn and then the Harrys with two Zeodrons and the Umbra.
Oh, yeah.
And
all day, baby.
You know, I'm going to have a tag left at the end of this unless you really, really, really try hard.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's a funny mission. Bring your long-range stuff, put it to the middle, and gives you the opportunity to play with tags. Be prepared to take out tags. Be prepared to support your own tags with the anti-hacker. And engineers and all that good stuff. And yeah, it's on the docket for two real big tournaments this year at least. And we're playing it at a local tournament coming up at the end of January here at the local game shop as well. So have fun with it. And you know, if you're mad because those four sectorials don't have access to a tag, we'll play one of the other 33 possible armies that you can choose. Or just go all out denial mode and make their tags your number one takeout priority. Haha, I speculo your gecko.
Oh, yeah.
And now I speculo the next gecko and then the next one. How many can you take? Four? yeah. So show of force. Let's hear your thoughts about it. Send an email to tom@myacast.com.
And kib@myacast.com.
And maybe one of you listening is going to play one of us at Rumble on this very mission. That'll be fun. And you'll kill my tags and make me sad. Now, what do we got to do? We got to give away a lot of Patreon prizes. Mm-hmm. And then there's also a special treat we have. So make sure you keep listening until the end.
Conversation can serve no purpose anymore. Goodbye.
Thank you so much to all of our patrons over at patreon.com/MayaCast for supporting the show. We could not keep doing this without you, so thank you so much. And we are going to give away some prizes. We've got three pledge levels, the $1 an episode, the $3 an episode, and the $10 an episode. And it's really cool because you can set monthly limits. Like if you don't want to go over $30 a month, you can set a $30 a month limit. And even if we do 6 shows at $10 a show, you won't go over the... So that's really cool. And we give away prizes each month to our Patreon supporters. And so if you're interested in checking that out and see how you can support the show, please go to patreon.com/MayaCast. But we are 2 months behind, so we're going to give out 2 prizes for each level. And we've got November and December to give away. So we're going to start with the Light Infantry, $1 episode. And Light Infantry, any blister you want from the Infinity the Game range, any blister at all. And Light Infantry for November, the winner is one Spencer Clark.
And the December, any blister you want, is going to be Darius Wingate Purse.
So congratulations, guys. Send us an email with what blister you want, and we will get that out to you as soon as we can. Medium Infantry, the $3 tier. We have winner for November, Thomas Brandt.
And The December winner is Joachim Forsberger.
And so that's going to be any box set from the Infinity of the Game range. So any box set for the medium infantry. And the heavy infantry prize every month is really cool. It is a custom piece of sketch artwork from the very talented Florian Stitz. He works as a professional artist, don't you know? And he will take any Infinity-themed concept that you want. Like, he can take a picture of you from Facebook and he'll try and put that on a Xian if you want to be a Xian, right? There was a really cool Chibi Muib that Greg Patterson had done early on that was really cool. So really cool custom art pieces that you can hang in your hobby room or your gaming area. They're very, very cool. And the heavy infantry winner for November is
Mr. Tony Fern.
I feel like we've read his name several times. So that's lucky. And for December, the heavy infantry winner is Justin Reagan.
That's kind of funny that he's the heavy, because he lifts Civics with his legs.
Honda Civics. Not like the high school class.
No, he could probably lift the whole high school class. Yeah.
Congrats, Justin. Except you're supposed to lift with your legs, and we know he doesn't do leg day. So congratulations to those guys. We'll get your prize out as soon as you let us know what it is you want. Just send an email to tom@mayacast.com.
And kip@mayacast.com.
And if you want to support the show, you can go over to patreon.com/mayacast to find out how. Now, we're going to play the music that ends the show that has the credits in it with the emails and the Facebooks and all that stuff. But stick around to the very end, because once Jupiter fades out, right, we have a very special song for you. Remember how like listeners used to send in Infinity parody songs?
Yeah.
Well, it's that, but it's a little inside baseball, so I'm going to explain it just a little bit. For those of you in the four corners, right, the Southwest Super Meta, they'll kind of understand it, right? Because it's about our local named Tim, whose ITS name is Chainsaw.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a bunch of inside Dire Straits kind of jokes. And if you know Tim and his factions and his the way he just goes to all these big tournaments and wins. Yeah.
Just wins.
And just wins. Timothy the Smackdowner. He...
I was just looking at it in the chat.
Yeah. If you know, so it's a song about a local guy who goes to these big Infinity tournaments and wins, and it's called Toss a Drink to Your Chainsaw. And so you may recognize the tune from a slightly popular Netflix show that just came out a few weeks ago. And yeah, so that's going to do it for episode 257. I apologize for my voice. I'm no Jaskier, but... It's about the lyrics anyway. So that'll wrap up episode 257. Thank you so much for listening. We will be back in 1 week's time, where part of the show, we are going to announce the winners of the MayaCast Master Glass Quarter 4. And we will announce the theme for Quarter 1 of 2020, the new decade. The very first Masterclass of the new decade. So be sure to tune in next week for all of that. Thanks for listening. And until next time, get out there and support your local game stores.
To find out how you can support the show, go to patreon.com/MayaCast.
You can find us online at www.MayaCast.com.
We are on Facebook at facebook.com/InfinityMayaCast.
Follow at MayaPodcast on Twitter.
Join the MayaCast forum group on Facebook.
And as always, you can email us at tom@mayacast.com.
And kip@mayacast.com.
When a humble nerd brought a friend along named Tim Krug Killer, along came this song. Since then, the chainsaw fought from the Krug to Rumble, Armageddon to at showdown a slight stumble. He uses Max Swick when building all his lists. Solve it with bullets, yeah, you get the gist. My Omer has gone, and he came off the street, and so cried the chainsaw, he can't be bleat. Toss a drink to your chainsaw, oh corners of four states, oh corners of four states, yo ho ho. Toss a drink to your chainsaw, oh corners of four states. When not playing ninth age, or with magic cards, he'll bash you and break you with guns or with swords. He's a faction whore, he will make you guess. Attack Yujing or Rama, maybe ISS. Oh! He wiped out your list with his mighty fist. He's a friend of State 48, so please don't get pissed. That's my epic tale. Our champion prevailed, defeated dire states. Now pour him some mail. Toss a drink to your chainsaw, oh corners of four states, oh corners of four states, yo. Toss a drink to your chainsaw, a friend of State 48. Toss a drink to your chainsaw, oh smoke grenade ninja, I heard he's still sorry, yo. Toss a drink to your chainsaw, a friend of State 48. Toss a drink to your chainsaw, oh corners of four states, oh corners of four states, you monster. Toss a drink to your chainsaw, a friend of State 48.